Hey, I'm gonna call the meeting to order of the Salisbury Planning and Zoning Commission, February 19th. The first item will be the approval of the agenda. I have one correction I'd like to strike, item number four. We do not have a POCD minutes memo from Garrett. We do have a memo from Garrett, which will be discussed later on about the zoning edits under item number nine.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
We need to seat someone, please.
Oh, need the book. You are correct.
The book.
The book. Thank you, Mike. Happy with this. Mike, you are seated tonight. This is 219-13. You're in rotation. I'm seating Mike Flint as the voting alternate this evening. Thank you. Are there any other corrections, additions to the agenda? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion for approval, please.
So moved.
Alan, is there a second?
Second.
Second from Fred. All in favor?
Aye.
Good. Next item will be minutes of the 3rd of the father, the 5th of February. I was not there, so I'll defer to the rest of you to though I'm very curious about the 6,438 fee expenditure was. I'm sure we'll hear about that maybe later, Nancy.
Interestingly, well, sure, but we can do it. I was explaining to Kathy, when we got the budget worksheet from Joan, when I got it, it originally had on it registrars. But on the first line of registrars, it had zoning administrator salary. So it says registrars. So these things over here, none of this pertains to us. Okay. So I have a new budget.
Okay, good. All right. That was mine. So go ahead with the additions and corrections to the minutes, please.
The only thing I wanted to add is on page 2, line 3, at the end of that sentence, before it begins, Jay Higgins, I think we should do parentheses, documents attached, the engineering documents regarding the erosion and sediment control plan. Should we include that?
No, I don't believe those are part of the file.
Sediment control plan in lieu of information received from the engineer.
I don't believe so.
Right.
I think we do attach documents when they're like a memo or something that's not in an application file. If that's in an application file, that's my opinion.
No changes.
Okay. Anything else from anybody else?
Page 1, line 3. It appears that Tom McGowan was here and reported that he had reviewed and discussed the things here mentioned. After, on line 30 at the end, I would insert, after it says, Nancy Parisi also noted that certified letters to all abutting property owners have been sent and received, to insert, and that planning consultant Tom McGowan, Ben Strike, reported that he. So recent Nancy Brucey noted blah 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 and that Tom McGowan has reviewed and discussed.
Tom McGowan is not here.
Yes, that's not here. That's the point. That's the point. Looks like he was.
Yes.
Nancy reported that he had reviewed it. Okay. And then also on page 2, same thing. Line 14.
Yes.
Same wording.
That's your changes, your changes. Marty, any corrections?
No, I did not.
Kathy?
Mike?
No.
Well, then I'll entertain a motion for approval, please.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
Hello?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And I will abstain.
Thank you.
Please.
Okay.
All right, we move to item number, well, new number four. Any members of the public that have anything they wish to bring to the attention of the commission that is not part of a application or ongoing action? Yes, Wendy?
Switch glasses on, come on.
Hi, I'm Wendy Hamilton. I'm asked not to be emotional, so I will try. I will find my own spot as left as anger. I also want to make it really clear that I don't think that the complaints I'm about to make should be made in this venue. But there appears to be no other choice. You may have heard that we don't have an ethics commission. And I did speak with Michael and ask if, as a citizen, I could ask for an executive session. And I was told that I could not, so here I am.
Not for this year.
At the last planning and zoning meeting, your CEO made the decision to write about my private business in the CEO report, which is a matter of public record, and then chose to compound that by speaking about my private business in a public meeting for the record. That this is wildly inappropriate is the kindest thing that I can say about it. I realize that I'm at a disadvantage and that I don't know what you have requested or required of your CEO in terms of this reporting. So all I can do is try to imagine the reasons that you would ask for a report from the CEO. For example, is she supposed to write down everything that she does during her work hours? If so, then this half-page report represents all the work that she did from November 20 to February 1st. Is she supposed to write down only the most important or even time-consuming things she does? Hopefully, making two copies of the file wouldn't qualify on either count. Is she supposed to write down things that will be coming before the commission or that might affect the commission? Well, this is a private matter that has absolutely nothing to do with the town or with the commission, which only leaves reporting on gossip, which I don't imagine is what you asked her to do. I went through 6 months of P&Z records and found no other incident where she either wrote about or spoke about anyone's private business other than her own. I did find references to 12 issues that are clearly zoning issues, and even on these that are clearly zoning issues, she gave identifying information for only two of the 12. Clearly, the CEO cherry-picked this item to highlight, even though there was absolutely no reason to bring it up at all, at least no apparent reason. After reading about my private business in the CEO report, Kathy Shire asked about it at the meeting. I later spoke with Kathy and asked why she had brought it up. And she told me, and correct me if I'm wrong, please, that she didn't understand why it was even on there unless there was some action coming before P&Z, because certainly it wasn't an item that had taken much of the CEO's time. After Kathy brought this matter up in the meeting, the CEO had ample opportunity to simply say that this was a personal matter and had nothing to do with P&Z. But no, she took the opportunity to talk about what she thinks she knows and discuss my private business in a public meeting. The fact is that during the course of her response, she told two absolute, complete, total lies. Now, this part you might tell me is hearsay because I'm pretty sure no one is going to jump up and corroborate. But the fact is that the CEO has also been discussing my private business with individuals in town hall. And understand, this is not garden variety gossip. This is information that she has because of her job that came to her in the workplace. Some of those people have been good enough to call and let me know that this has been happening. On one memorable encounter, at least, she even burst into tears whining about how much copying these files is adding to her stress. You may be asking, what's the big deal? And I ask you, what if this is happening to you? This wasn't a mistake. It was intentional. The intention was to damage. The intention was to damage me. Surely you can appreciate that this can, and in fact already has, caused real damage. Not only have people been given details, largely inaccurate, about private matters, but now the gossip machine is charging away, and I have heard more than once that I'm suing the town. I'm asking that this one time, you really ask yourselves, what was the motivation for doing this? Personal vendetta? Somebody else telling her what to do? Either way, ask yourselves, maybe it's time finally to do something.
took you, Wendy.
No, discussing. All right. Has been noted in the record. All right. I guess we have the new and the old business reversed, which is also. I should say, is there anybody else that has anything they would like to say? No, I don't think there's any need to. I mean, Wendy has made a statement and it will be discussed. But I don't think we need to discuss it. Is there something that you feel you really must say?
Well, there is some accuracy in that, and Wendy, and I understand her concern and how greatly upset she is about this, but there was no discussion in a public meeting about the property any more than was read out of the CEO. The one question I asked in the CEO's office, I received a very brief answer.
That's the answer I'm referring to. I took this off the tape.
Okay. All right. I'd like to move on. I think this has been, we have heard it, and it will be discussed with the CEO. Her performance review, we'll discuss this too. All right. Now, I know old business and new business is reversed for some reason. Is there a reason you did that, or should we?
We did it because we wanted, well, we felt the new business shouldn't have to wait for the old business.
Okay, why don't we look at the month? Okay, so let's start. There are two, we're very pleased to see that there are two items on the firehouse coming before us. And I guess the first one is with Attorney Shushak. I never can get it right, I'm sorry. Is she here? Oh, there. Why don't you come on up and discuss?
Was everybody able to see my proposed letter to
Yes.
So it really kind of summarizes what Alex and me, who are the owners of Jam, like to consider with the firehouse.
Now let me just say something here, maybe just before the preface both of these, if I may, for a minute.
Do you mind using the microphone?
No, I'm just get back. I'm sharing the microphone. Let me preface this. This is sort of the process that I think we want to go forward with proposals for the firehouse. That the first step is going to be that proposed uses will come to the commission to get sort of a sense of what the commission feels about them as being consistent with the plan of conservation development. There haven't been formal offers made or contracts or any of this. It's basically, rather than have what happened in the past, where it gets all fleshed out, an agreement is reached on a price, and it comes to the planning commission, and we feel that for some reason it doesn't meet the goals of the POCD. Discussing this with Curtis, we reversed basically the procedure, where before people come with a formal offer, before it goes to the Board of Selectmen, Board of Finance, before there's a town meeting which has to approve any sale, they're coming here first for a sense of what of how the commission would view these proposals fitting very in two spheres, as a conformity of the zoning, and whether or not it actually, we had this whole discussion for whether this meets our goals of creating vitality within downtown Lakeford. We mentioned previous proposals in a sense they weren't. So this is why the whole process has been reversed. And this is why we're having these presentations tonight. There may be other presentations. Our goal is not to discuss the price, to discuss the deal. Our goal is basically to look at the content of what is being given to us and whether that is something that we feel would be a good and appropriate use of municipal property being sold. So we have yes, Al?
Question in regard to zoning. Will this require a zone change?
No. It depends. Some of them might, and that's a question of a zone change, but it may require a special permit. It may require We have to see, but I mean, the question is to me, is this something that we feel is good and worth going forward with?
It is not a piece of property that's exclusive to the Lakeville zone. It's not a unit in itself, it's not commercial, municipal, residential.
But I think the question is, one of the questions is, does the commission feel that we want to work with an applicant on this thing? There may have to be adjustments made, there may be variances needed, but the question is, is there overwhelming public good, and is this what we want to see as planners for Lakeville? That's really what it is, as planners, is this the kind of activity we feel is useful? Sorry, not, that's what Bonnie needed to practice.
I appreciate that overview, and I thank you for it, it helps in, in our preparation and maybe answering any questions. But I do believe, other than, and Ms. Brucey, you will speak to this, it is my understanding that other than the use as a firehouse or possibly a garage, we would have to come before your commission for any other change in use. That is my understanding, sir. And it wouldn't be a variance, it would be a special...
Change of use.
Yeah.
Change of use.
But there may, in fact, on some of these things, have to be variances on parking or something too. That's the process of creative planning. If it's something that works in the community and makes sense for the community, then I think that we have to figure out if this is something that fits and can work. To make planning work for the community, doesn't necessarily have to be a lock, sort of a lock this thing into a box. We need to be creative.
So essentially, I'm the attorney and I represent Lee Kennedy and Alex Elliott. They are the owners of Kennedy Foods LLC and Jam Foods. Jam Food had a nice little shop in Sharon and did quite well. And then when given an opportunity at the request of the new owners of the Sharon Farm Market, moved in there and are now running there, now running the deli and the bakery, and are doing quite well. In fact, everything I've always said to Lee Kennedy, the co-owner, that seems anything she's touched, it seems to grow and grow. And at this juncture, they've kind of grown out of the space at the farm market. And Lee has come forward, Lee and Alice have come forward, and think that perhaps the firehouse would be a great opportunity for them to expand on a very healthy food market. They also want to concentrate on local artisans and having local art, giving local artisans a place to display wares. They would like to mainly be a takeout food, but they would like to ask the commission if things go well and it moves along for some eat-in as well. They are obviously, I know in Sharon, they're very, very community-oriented people, and they feel, and I believe this would be a wonderful market, an open-air market that would help highlight the Lakeville area. With the all the small back galleries and other businesses there, the lake there, it seems to me that it would be a nice place to help create a nice community for the Lakeville area. So essentially, that's what they're after. They certainly want to work with since Lee and Alex have always accentuated high quality, fresh, local foods. The idea, for example, of having a farmer's market there during the seasonal farmer's market is something they would obviously welcome. We would like to perhaps in the evenings maybe do cooking classes there. That's the kind of thing they're looking for, a nice open air market. And that's essentially what they like to do. They like to buy it, make some renovations. Lee and Alex are aware that it's in the historic district. They're also aware that the firehouse is a part of the federal historic places. So all of that will be taken into account if things move on.
What is the plan for the way forward?
That, at this juncture, since the two buildings are separated, at this juncture, they're not necessarily interested in purchasing the white building. They are two separate buildings, and they're two separate parcels.
They're separate parcels?
Yes, sir. Yes, they are, sir.
Okay.
So that they can be sold separately. So if the town wanted to retain the small white building, that's fine. If the town wanted to sell the white building to someone else. If the Planning and Zoning Commission said, no, Amy, we want Lee and Alex to buy the whole enchilada, then we'd rethink our plan, and we could go forward with that. They're very open to any kind of ideas and suggestions and recommendations.
I don't see anything here that would conflict with our POCD. Perhaps enhance it.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
Oh, this is the kind of proposals we've been waiting to
receive. Yeah.
This is to get something that actually has people and activity and life and meeting and gathering. I mean, this is what we want. This is what we talk about vitality, at least in my vision. It's about a building that actually has people going in, doing things, and contributing to the life of the thing.
And again, I can't stress enough that the local aspect of it, the fresh seasonal aspect of what Lee and Alex have been doing for over 20 years, I think would really complement the area as well.
So your goal would be basically to have it as a takeout market, with the seating really being excessive and accessory use to the primary use, which would be the takeout.
Yes, that's correct.
And you mentioned possible residential or commercial use upstairs.
Yeah, eventually, we don't want to bite off more than we can chew right away, but eventually, yes. Lee and Alex have in mind that as time goes on, they'd love to put apartments upstairs. If it's doable, if our fire marshal thinks it's okay, you guys okay, eventually that is something they would love to do.
To put apartments up. Yeah.
A couple of apartments, maybe an office and an apartment, but certainly that is one thing we have mentioned to me on several occasions. Whether it's doable, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. That's a good question.
But
many different views on the usability of that for residents. We have a gentleman at the end of the committee, at the end of the table, who has quite a lot of thinking about that.
But it's a lot, having done this in other towns, and never with a firehouse, an older firehouse, it's a lot. And I'm the one that's kind of putting the brakes on Lee. But again, one thing at a time. They like to, the downstairs at this point would really be more like an open air kind of market. And again, local artisans, that's the kind of thing Lee's has in mind.
So I'm going to ask Judy Swan some questions because she's not here. What are you going to do with the doors?
That's a great idea.
Do you plan to make them glass or what?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, Judy will. She'll be very happy. Yes.
I think it's very much with the POCD, and I worked with Judy on that section, and I think, I think absolutely in line with what we would all positively dream about.
It's wonderful. Yes. Plus, it's Lee and Alex do employ a lot of people, so. To the more, we're hoping it would bring more employment to the area and certainly more people.
The only challenge that I would see is the parking, but yeah, I mean, I think there's probably enough.
We could walk
space there. Wouldn't that be a change? We could bike.
I think, there is a lot of off-site in the immediate area. So it's not as if anything in that part of Lakeville necessarily needs to have a lot of its own parking.
Correct.
With the amount we have there. One of my questions would be is, according to what Nancy and I discussed before as I was looking at the zone, this use would require a special permit?
No. It's the other,
The other use, this one would be an as-right use.
Special permit.
This would be a special permit.
Yes, because it changes.
But, I mean, the question becomes, I think it's more looming, is the commission feeling the special use permit would be in order for this? Because you could say we like the idea, but are we willing to give it a special permit?
I certainly, for one, I say...
I would say yes.
I would be inclined to.
Absolutely.
You don't have to go to a public hearing.
Certainly here.
Oh, yeah.
And you want to, you know, listen to what people have to say about it, but...
I think it's a very...
Because you're in a primarily business area, you don't have much residential close by. I don't see, and I think business people want a business down there.
Right.
And this sounds active.
That sounds very...
And all year too, which is nice.
It also sounds flexible, there's some other things they could branch off into, cooking classes. I mean, there's a lot that could happen in a place like that. I think it's exciting, a very exciting proposal. Thank you for bringing it.
Thank you.
Anybody else have a question? Any other, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Good luck. Thank you.
So we then go to the next proposal, which is a discussion with Bill Burke Miskel regarding the former Maple Firehouse.
Good evening.
Having two successful businesses in one night.
Been waiting a long time.
It's a nice night. It's a good night, right?
It is.
Has everybody got a copy of my proposal here?
Yes.
First, let me introduce myself. My name is Bill Burke Miskel. I'm the new owner of the Northeast Fitness and Wellness, which is currently in Millerton, formerly known as Northeast Athletic Club. I'm interested in moving my business to the Lakeville, Salisbury area, as I just recently moved to Salisbury. So it would cut down on my commute.
Could you just talk into the microphone? Would that be okay?
Yeah,
I'm sorry, it's my fault. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. Currently, I am in the Thompson Plaza on Route 44 in Millerton. And at this point, I feel that moving into the Lakeville area with a fitness and wellness center would be a good fit for the firehouse. From the keeping with the historic part of the firehouse, my plan is to keep the doors as is or even make them into glass, and that allowing me to open them up during the open them, not fully, but open them up a little bit to allow air in and to keep the facade of the building as is. My plan is for the separate building would be to use it as a what I consider an access center to hold my classes, where I have spinning, Zumba, Pilates, yoga, and CrossFit, and also to use that as access to acupuncture, nutrition, chiropractic, and possibly medical, a doctor. My plan, my philosophy with the Northeast Fitness and Wellness is a very comprehensive approach. And that's why I think that the firehouse with the adjacent building, would be a very good fit. We have the fitness and wellness center there, but also the adjacent building would allow us to do the nutrition, the chiropractic, acupuncture, etc. My plan would be for the upstairs would be to just use that for classroom activity. I really feel that right now, where I am in Millerton, I really want to, predominantly, my population is male. Like I said, in the proposal or in the memo, it's at 42 years old. You know, I really feel that in this area, we're missing out on, at least I am now, on the female population and also senior programming. I would really like to open it up and get seniors involved in senior programming. That's my background. I'm a retired physical therapist who work with the geriatric population. So I really feel it's important to have some type of a program, some senior program for the community.
Do you intend to keep the one in Northeast and then just have two facilities?
No. My plan is to, my lease is, I have about 13 months left on my lease there with a renewal if I so choose. But no, my plan is to move the whole facility, fitness and wellness center, to Lakeville Firehouse if it was feasible.
And there's sufficient space in there?
Absolutely.
To accommodate your program or your expanded program?
Absolutely. Especially with the adjacent building and the second story over the.
The firehouse
itself. Ideally, I'm looking at about 6,000 square feet, and I think the firehouse is about 5,800 square feet, if I'm not mistaken. So, from a square footage standpoint, it would be fine.
You're in 6,000 square feet now.
No, I'm probably a little bit less, but with the programming and the growth of the programming, I figure that 6,000 square feet should be ideal for what my vision is for the place.
I have one of the questions is more a zoning question. Mm-hmm. When you start mixing the doctor and the acupuncture, how does that work? Because then that we have separate set of
there's requirements. Separate criteria for what. The firehouse, it should be noted, is in the LI-20 zone district, which currently prohibits an exercise center.
So we need a zoning variance?
So is you would... According to our...
Well,
according to our map and to our, and to our regulations, I was looking and we went over this.
Yeah.
Currently prohibits an exercise center.
The LI-20.
LI-20. Really, I mean, we're looking for commercial uses for this property. Maybe it shouldn't be in the LI-20 zone. Maybe
it should be in a commercial.
It should be in a commercial zone.
The only reason it's in the LI-20 is when they put zoning in. Coyle and Esser had their slide rule division there.
Uh-huh.
Man had a machine shop in back of the firehouse.
And the Lakeville Journals in the
Lakeville Journals said, yeah. So I agree. I don't think it should be in that LI-20. It's too small.
So you could, scoop the CG20 zone, or however you choose to do it.
So there, we might want to consider that in any case.
Correct.
Right. I mean,
correct.
I think you should make this property attractive to everyone. So that it's, I didn't realize it was. Where does that zone go? Then that zone continues back further. It's a very small.
It's
zone.
Very small zone. It's right here.
Does that involve the?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's that same, that split. You know, there's nothing that's going to, either of these uses affect that aquifer either, right?
No.
None of these are prohibited for the aquifer overlay.
No.
They're not dry cleaning, they're not doing any.
They're auto mechanic, no.
Right. Yeah. So, wow, this little thing. Wow, that's a tiny little thing, isn't it?
The zone.
It's all little.
Wait a second.
All little.
LI-20. Where does it go as far as to where does it? I don't see that.
Just refer to the road. Mm-hmm.
I see the CG, G20 run right up here to.
Is it based on the color.
Yeah.
And you might be able to add the color, so.
It's based on the color.
I like points those to here, to actually to the village.
Well, why do I have this line here in this map?
Well, this is the road.
That's the road.
This is Route 40.
I understand that, but it's also showing the boundaries.
No, it's not a zone boundary.
Okay.
All right, so there's Patco here in this, in the CG 20.
Patco is the road. Patco is in CG 20.
Yeah, Patco's in the CG 20.
CG 20, yeah.
And the firehouse is in the
LI.
Ethan Allen Street's already in the CG 20.
Right.
It's a rural city.
It's that rural one side of it, the other side of it's not.
Right.
With a town having railway station.
What's the purpose of that? I said, oh, regulations.
It's just there because of.
They exist as a time.
It exists as a time.
You need to rezonate.
That's what was going on there.
Yeah, right.
So that number makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, that's right.
Kind of, yeah.
Yes. I think you should take the whole, zone out and make it commercial.
Certainly would not.
Actually, as Alan just said, there was already an exercise facility down here.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was. There was, quite a few years ago.
Yeah.
Was that behind the boathouse?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Was that Peter?
Peter Oliver.
Peter Oliver, yes, was right there, yeah.
But that was a different one.
Well.
It was under the Iowa Studio.
That's a question that we should.
No, there was one in the KNE too.
Yeah, that was a KNE.
And what was that, zone?
Large industrial, so.
LI was also.
So it was a case of use of the design.
Is that the only one industrial we have now?
No.
We have the other one. The new firehouse.
Right.
That's really.
I mean, the question is, do you really want light industrial zone in that overlay?
Yeah.
We should get rid of the whole zone. Put that on this. Yeah, maybe we have something, we put that on our planning list, because we maybe eliminate that zone.
Well, if you're talking about that, and wanting to move a firehouse, that should be on top of the list to eliminate that zone. It only makes sense.
Right, well, I think we should.
Be a high priority. Before sign regulations.
Yes, I agree with you, that's what. Okay, well, why don't we have Tom prepare sort of draft?
Draft regulations.
Remove it. Now, I guess right now we're doing these regulations, it's probably going to be table change again, right?
Yes.
We're going to remove it from the table and that.
And we have to remove it from the maps and things, that's what.
Probably worthwhile.
Time to do it.
Yeah, now's the time to do it, seeing we're already delayed anyway on these regulations.
It's going to make it much easier for everyone to deal with that firehouse.
Why do we do that?
Another discussion to have. We need to discuss it at length.
Well, I think if we get a proposal to remove it, then we can discuss it. We can discuss it, yes, not here, but.
Right. Why don't we have Tom draft up and see if there's any downside to it? We have to have a public hearing, we have to go to COG, I mean, we can't do it. Can't do it 1, 2, 3.
Will they go to COG?
It has to go.
Right, Peter, absolutely right, they don't have to go to COG.
No, it's not within the 500.
No, so we just have to do, we have to have a public hearing.
But it is a zone change.
That has to go to COG.
That has to go to COG.
I thought so.
A zone change has to go.
Oh, zone change has to go to COG, anyway.
Right. Irrespective, it's a zone, send it to COG. At least we move it along. I think that's. Do you want to say?
No, any questions?
Well, my only concern is the whole issue of the doctor, chiropractic, and how that fits, because we do have distinct standards. Whether or not that can be accommodated within what you do.
It all depends, if you change it to the commercial.
Well, it's not just that there's, it's not just the formula, it's also different, very different. I mean, you know, it's something, but you could figure that out.
Is it just BMD, or is it?
I have to put.
Or is it all, like the massage therapy, acupuncture, nutrition, chiropractic?
I think the chiropractic and the, are one thing. I think nutrition, massage, acupuncture, things that are traditionally looked often that occur at precinct. Maybe the satellite doctor's office that you mentioned that.
Exactly.
Might give some pause whether it can all be accommodated there. It might be.
Well, currently now, professional or business office in the LI-20 is a special permit. It's allowed by special permit. In the LI-1, it's permitted without anything. And it's permitted both in the C-20 and CG-20. And that's what they would be, professional offices.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's the only thing.
And then you have to think of the parking for space and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Any members of the commission?
I think that, again, a great suggestion in terms of the vitality of the village center, people coming and going, and I appreciate the sensitivity to the fellow members of the community.
Yeah.
Very real in our community.
Yeah, and I think it would really bring some vitality to this area, especially getting involved with the community, both with, you know, senior programming, and also on the high school level, you know, school, along those lines.
So instead of eating on the public toilet across the road, they come and exercise.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Well, I think just a sense of the commission, this is also something we would support then.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Very exciting.
I wanted to say, I think it's consistent with our POCD, but I think technically right now, so if there isn't any zone change.
Right. Well, I think the zone change, I think, yeah, I mean, that would be something to look at. That certainly wouldn't move it out at all.
May I ask how long you have found the facility in Milton?
I recently just bought it in October. And I had done a lease of the prior owners for 18 months, so I'm 5 months into it. So I have another, you know, 13, 14 months there.
Oh, yeah, I just, these are concepts, or do they have to agree on it? Proposal, they have to agree, there's a lot of steps. This is, again, I think this commission would be supportive of doing what was necessary for either of these proposals. Both of them are very, very much about the kind of thing we've been waiting to see.
Mm-hmm.
Both of the proposals are the kind of stuff that we wanted to see happen here in Mayfair.
Can I ask what would be the next step that would need to be done?
Well, as I understood it, you have to go and meet with the Board of Selectmen. I think you have to basically make a proposal to purchase it.
Okay.
That would be, I think, what you will get is you're not going to get what the previous round of things when they came to us, sort of a sense this doesn't really fit. I think you've got a sense of this commission that this would fit.
Yeah.
Would fit with our planning. There has to be a zone change, but it wouldn't, we're not, I think people feel that zone is probably antiquated and not needed.
Exactly.
It is likely to be changing the zone for you.
Yeah.
We changed the whole zone because I don't think it fits anymore. Because we also have an overlay that is now in that area, which actually many of the light industrial uses are not prohibited there. That would be there. So in fact, this is sort of a holdover. So it's not like we'll change the zone for you, but I think you've heard here tonight that it's probably good public policy to change the zone for whatever it should probably be eliminated. So that would be the only. I think our major is a little bit more complicated. On the other hand, you're 13 months out. By the time you were to make an offer and the time that your offer may be accepted and then it has to go to town meeting where it's approved, that's ultimately, whatever you propose, any deal, has to be approved by the citizens. They will go in the town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
But you're through the first step in a sense that this planning commission feels this is something that would fit with our goals of revitalizing our vitality and so.
And my plan is to purchase both the firehouse and the adjacent building.
The white building,
right, yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you both for coming with such exciting proposals. Waited a long time to get things like this coming to us. All right. Budget. What do we have to discuss? We have a new budget now.
This is actually the correct budget.
Correct budget, wrong.
I mean, with the correct budget. I mean, basically, what you want, I think, I don't know what you want to do with the CG printing. You want to be back there.
Okay, can we?
I prefer digital forms.
Can we have some focus, please? Mike, please, thank you. We have some budget lines that Nancy's wondering. A POCD printing, that was taken on by the select, wasn't it yet?
No, it was actually included in the money that we left $4,000 of the grant.
Yes.
And we only spent like $1,500 of it.
Why is it original adjusted? I can't read what it says.
Let me see.
It seems like the original was $4,000.
$4,000.
And adjusted to $4,000.
And then we actually expended $2,100. Which leaves us with $1,900 left.
Now, the idea of the POCD that we were supposed to be able to make copies as they were wanted, so we need to have some budget line in there for POCD.
Well, we started out with 150 copies.
Yes.
And I still have 100 copies left. The commission members have them, the ZBA members have them, the selectmen have them.
So what would be a realistic amount? How much is it per unit copy? Is it $20?
$12.50.
$12.50. So we have 100 on hand, and there's no way banging down the doors for them.
And they're on the website as well.
Do you think we need?
I don't think you need to have it.
Well, it's always nice to show that we're reducing our budget. It makes everybody very happy, as long as we don't reduce ourselves to oblivion. You don't think we need a POCD printing line?
No, I don't.
I agree.
And okay, is that, how does the rest of the group feel?
I agree.
I agree.
Kathy?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry, how many did we print originally?
150, we have 100 left.
100 left. Fine.
Maybe after tonight, everyone was going to come after hearing this great document.
The degree is. Signed copies.
All right. Now, we don't do anything with the clerical recording. We seem to be right on target with three. Wait a second. We only spent $827 of that?
Well, remember, some of Garrett's was under POCD as well.
Right.
POCD, all
right. Right, so that was right. She's the POCD coordinator.
So.
Is this the...
But I think we may want to be using Garrett for other things too, mm-hmm. So I would not feel comfortable. I think maybe we could get away with cutting it from 3,000 to 1,500, but I wouldn't do any more than...
Well, since you're taking out the $4,000, you're taking out for the POCD, yeah. You could take some of that and put up to her salary.
Well, right now we have 3,000 right. In her salary, of which might be 827 were actually spent.
Mm-hmm.
I don't like the idea of having budgets that are so inflated because that gets reflected obviously mm-hmm. In the mill rate.
Right.
I mean, it's really, people say, well, it doesn't bad to over budget, but actually it is bad mm-hmm. Because, mm-hmm. So the question is.
But if you look at the incorrect budget we were given at the last meeting, and these figures are right, we spent in actual 2012, $2,372 in clerical and recording.
But that budget at the last, this budget that we were given at the last meeting
was for the right.
The only thing that was correct on it, it said zoning administration salary. Yeah. Everything else below it is incorrect.
Mm. Oh, no. So it's just coincidence that the approved 13 budget is $3,000 and it's the same amount as this.
Wait,
that's just a coincidence.
This is not, I'm sorry, this is not correct. This cannot be correct.
No.
I mean, where's Tom McGowan? Land use planner.
He's right here.
I was going to ask.
$15,000.
But we've not expensed any of it. How is that possible?
We have available, according to.
I got it.
This says we have $15,000 still in there.
Well, we have paid those.
And we paid him.
We better, you know what, we better go in and see Joe tomorrow and ask him for Jan, because this is, obviously we've paid bills for Tom, I know Tom doesn't get his bills in on time.
Right.
But we made him get it in for the fiscal year, and I know there shouldn't be $15,000.
No, there shouldn't.
Is there any way they can run us the columns from the previous year?
Right, that's what we're missing here.
You know, this is really, to me, this is kind of a blind budget. It's really nice if you can see budgeted and expensed from last year, and then budgeted and expensed from this year.
We could, we certainly have not, I'm sorry, I don't believe it, it's not right, Brian.
It's not very much.
No, it's not right, Mr. Hatchell, this is not correct.
That even applies to the administrators, so we're over halfway through the fiscal year here.
Yes.
And you know, she's not showing, she's still showing less than 50% out there.
Well, they've expensed 50, yeah.
Yeah, and we're over.
And we see the percentage, 40% is available, I don't understand, this is the detail from 101-2012.
This is through December 11th, 2012.
No, it's not, it's through November 30th, 2012.
Okay.
November 30th, yeah.
It's an 11 month, so they're running, I guess they closed 1 month behind. But you're right, we want to see, because we have been actually, I'd like to do also projections to show where our actual totals have been, because we have been reducing the amount of spike, we are going down. My fear is we can't go too far, because then we'll have nothing to work with.
But why is this from the first of the year to the 30th? I mean, our fiscal year is the first of July to the end of June.
It is that way, Mike, because when I looked at it today, when I came in tonight, and I looked at the confusion of registrars, this is what I had as far as categories.
I understand, but this is at the time.
You're saying it's running on a calendar year.
1-1-12, yeah, we don't work on a calendar.
We work on a fiscal.
Our fiscal year begins July 1 and ends June 30.
But we need to know.
So these numbers don't even, they don't tell us anything.
We need to know where we are now.
Yeah, we need to know the fiscal year.
Well, we're in the middle of the fiscal year right now.
Right. Sorry, Kathy?
Can I suggest that we just ask for a copy and not waste any more time on this? But have the headings the way they were given to us last year, which is last time, which is the actual expenses for the year.
Right.
You know, 2010, the year 2011, and 2012.
That's the way it should be, yes.
But the adjusted line is nothing.
On our fiscal year.
Right.
On the town's fiscal year makes more sense than what's on here.
Correct.
And then to have the correct lines would be good too.
This is crazy.
Yeah.
It's like we're not spending anything. Well, it's not true, they've spent more than that.
That's not true.
But I mean, yeah, we're being asked to approve a budget for the fiscal year that's running. Yeah, it should run the fiscal.
July to June.
Right, we should be looking at.
Where we are now and what's.
This is not helpful.
Year to date ending, you know, December 2012 compared to year to date ending 2011. So we can see how we're tracking.
How we're tracking from one year to the other.
Yeah, as well as the total expenditures for 2011 and 12.
Not maybe the time to think about whether we want to get a half-time land use plan that actually works for us. I mean, that's not what I meant. Excuse me. That's dumb. What I mean, it actually works for us, meaning it's actually dedicated to working here. At one point, we had a discussion where we wanted to have someone that actually was here in the land use office for that, and maybe before we give away all these lines, we should look what it would cost to get a half-time land use planner in the office working with Nancy doing some of this stuff, because I think, you know, we may be at the time where we really need to think about that.
But when you look at that, do you look at that as an employee or a subcontractor?
Well, what I'd like.
Expenses can be.
Oh, I agree with you. What I'd like to suggest on this, the most economical ways, we do not want to add more employees. Everyone doesn't want employees. But you can go to planning firms. Planometrics, not the only one in town. They actually have, where they actually have an employee that is half-time Salisbury. It's a Planometrics employee. They do, it's built into the cost. We don't have, all the benefits issues, we don't have the employee, we don't have any other issues. I would like to explore, and with your permission, I would like to call up a few people and say, what would it cost to get a halftime planning presence here in the office that could do a lot of the stuff that Tom does, plus more? Would you be in favor of me making those inquiries?
Please.
Yes, please do.
Yes. And what it would cost to get them, because I think at this point, and I think we need to really look at a different model to get planning services, and we can get, there's a lot of people out there, and I've heard this from a lot of different people, that we want to really think about this. I think Tom is at a stage in his career, he's near retirement. And we offered him the chance to come in and do exactly that, Krista and I, first, but then it never materialized. We need a planner that is here more than a meeting, someone that becomes more engaged with what goes on in Salisbury, that knows what's going on, and can be more a partner with us, rather than a case by case. Doesn't mean we still won't charge escrow and charge rates. But I mean, I think we should, it may be time to look at that.
Well, but as well, if you have someone you contracted with, you now know the price, it's not a variable. Like you said, we're working on hours and it's
that person,
you know what that cost is, and that allows you to set better escrows and everything else. It's fair to the people that are coming to the commission, because now you set escrows that are kind of, let's pick a number.
We set escrows basically on an estimate plus about a 10 or 15% cushion. It's always a little bit more and we give it back. That's the best you can do, but that's escrow, but we'd have a whole different thing. It actually may be in a per hour less, because, right now we're paying $85 an hour for planning services. I don't know what that end up, it may be the same actually when you end up basically having it.
Maybe it's how we've been scaling, and we're always going back to that formula.
We've been going to the
same. How long is it going to take?
We put a little bit of cushion. The last thing we're going to do is to go back and ask. And I don't think any of our escrows have really been way over. I think if you give $100 back, it's better than going back and asking for $250 more. But I think it's time for us to look more creatively. I'm going to call Don Poland and see what is out there. I know a lot of towns, they do very well with a halftime person. You don't have to have the person on staff.
I think that sounds great. Nancy, two questions. When there was a budget discussion with PNZ this time last year, there must have been a budget document from Joe's office. Maybe
there was.
It would be worthwhile to get that out. That's the one that everybody liked working with, was able to work with, and make sure that that's what's coming back next time.
Okay.
Okay, so we don't have another discussion with a report that we can't work with. Right.
I agree. And I think the other thing is, before we're too quick about giving away, I mean, our budget has gone down considerably. So we want to think about this staff, this non-staff, this contracted person. We shouldn't be too hasty about giving too much back yet, because we may not be able to afford it. I mean, our budget for planning is pretty modest for most towns.
And my other question is, there's a budget here of $1,000 for school. Is that in training? Is that the total cost of it? It's $1,000.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
But there's also mileage involved in that.
Yeah, I understand.
And there's also time, staff time, so it's not just $1,000 for school. There's $1,000, there is the mileage, and there is also the hours that Nancy works. So in fact, it's a much larger ticket item.
Yeah, mileage is also in there.
Right, and then part of Nancy's salary also, but I think that's one of the things we're going to bring up, is that a question of whether Nancy really wishes to, and we feel it's in the best interest to do the training at this point. And I had a chance to speak to some of you I didn't have a chance to actually talk to about it last week. But I think there's a sense that maybe this is not the best use of Nancy's time or our resources. But these are all things that we need. So that might be, because when Don Poland made a recommendation, he had tiers of recommendations. The Casio training for Nancy was one of the tier three recommendations. We've sort of cherry picked within the Poland report what we wanted to do. And we'll discuss this, and Nancy and I are going to discuss this with Curtis and Fred. There's a sense that may not be, at this point, something you want to do particularly. And the question is whether it's really in the best interest of the commission or the community to spend this money.
Is it unusual to have a CEO in a town that hasn't been through the training?
I've been through the training.
Oh.
Once before. Okay. I just didn't finish my case study years ago. So I've had the training.
Okay, that's new information.
Is it a training you have to do every year or?
No, it's once.
Just once?
Once.
There's also a way to get CASIO training here on site.
Yeah.
It's just, the question is, Nancy's been pretty clear that.
Go ahead.
Why don't you say?
I'll say.
It's yours. I'm not here.
So the whole community can see it on television now. I'm going to be 60 years old in July.
Good for you.
My goal is to retire at 62. So I really don't think it's worthwhile for the town or myself to spend the money and the energy to send me to school when.
First, you've already done it, you said, so.
And plus, I've already done it once.
Okay.
I just don't have the case study so that I can say that I am a CASIO graduate, so to speak. That's my goal. That's my thoughts.
And the question is, if Nancy did it, she'd be start when in March?
March,
and the office, you know, there would be a significant investment. And the question is whether, I mean, other than Nancy's wishes, whether or not it's an investment well recovered.
And it takes about 18 months to finish by the time you do the schooling plus your case study. Because I have to start all over again. I cannot just do the case study because it's been so many years.
I'm inclined, you know, to not pursue it at this point. I mean, when Kristen was very wanted it, but at the time Nancy wanted to work longer. Nancy's circumstances have changed. And at the time, since then, it's also been 2 years, which we've not been able to do it for various reasons. And the question is really, we're at the point, I think, of diminishing returns on the investment. And Nancy was saying, I want to do it, then I would say, well, we'll do it. But if the CEO doesn't want it, and I don't see what we really gain from it, I think Nancy's point that she actually has taken the schoolwork, just didn't do the case study, I don't think we'd get significantly better. I don't think we'd get much better than we have now. I mean, I think this is, I don't think it's not going to make a big difference. And I think, again, I would rather take some of these money lines and start thinking about a transition. Nancy's going to retire. I'd like to get someone into the land use office in this part-time planner thing that would at least know the ropes, so when Nancy did retire,
yeah,
it would be, and even then, you know.
So there's some training.
Is that person going to need this course?
Not if it's a planner.
It's a planner, no.
No.
Okay.
They have it, but, you know, but I think, I just feel we should not wait until Nancy retires and all of a sudden have a land use office with no one in it, no continuity.
Yeah.
Nancy knows an awful lot, she knows all this community. It'd be great to have someone coming in. I think now's the time to think about it.
I agree.
I think we have a transition that's orderly, that you know, person can get all the knowledge from Nancy of what she knows and understand.
And then more, you know.
Yeah, but I'm saying you also, but I mean, you know, just to turn over an office, that office has been run by you for what?
14 years.
I mean, it's much easier to have an orderly transition than Nancy leave and then someone comes in and try to figure it out. And also, you could, you know, give Nancy a chance to help the person. So I think it's sort of a good, makes some good management sense. And I think what it really means is basically taking the line that we've used for Tom and using it really in a different way.
Mm-hmm. When does the town need us to finalize budget figures for
sooner than later?
Yes, we should.
Well, we have some work to find out what it would cost to hire such a person.
Well,
and I would tend to move it on the generous side.
Don't you think personnel-wise, with this now on the table, that we should maybe beef it up a little just to make sure we meet the idea of that part-time planner, or I'm not sure I understand the full concept. A ZEO and a part-time planner, or just a planner? But if we're going to have somebody in to take over an office, many offices have assistants in them now who are learning those ropes, and especially someone who's run an office as long as Nancy has. She has her ways that aren't some kind of a thing that's set down in stone, and they're not bad ways, but people have to learn how that works, and we should probably be planning to start pulling somebody in sooner than later.
Well, that's
this close. So it's going to take a little extra, there, not giving up budget money.
Right, I agree. What I see basically is there are many younger planners that don't come at the same price, and also they're more willing to do some of the things that traditionally, but many of these small communities have planners that really function as planners, but also function as land use administrators. We have one in Litchfield, for example. You have a couple of good examples of planners, people with AICP degrees, some of them with PhDs, the one in Litchfield has a PhD. You have people that are really, and they're also doing the clerical, they don't make that distinction. I mean, in a way, the idea that the planner is up here and the CEO is there, and that's sort of a thing of the past. You can try to get someone that maybe functions as both, and then maybe has a land use secretary or something. They're different models. But I think we can't wait till Nancy retires before we start thinking about this. And I think really the opportunity I see, and I don't feel bad about it, I have a lot of respect for Tom, but we offered Tom this ability to become, we offered him a desk, he would come here, he doesn't want to do it. He doesn't want to come from Litchfield, it's not his thing. And he's been very honest about it. So I think he would understand that we want to go this way. I don't think it would be if it were, I have a lot of respect for Tom, but I think we have to think about how we move this town to the next level. Yes, Al?
So our next budget discussion is March 5th.
We've got it soon.
Oh, all right, that's right. No, this is our second meeting. So it is our first March meeting.
Yes, this is not the system. I missed one, yes.
It was great fun.
I think you did wonderful. I don't think I'll come to so many of them.
Will it be possible to have those numbers from Joe a few days, with our packet?
With your packet.
As opposed to, at the table?
Mm-hmm. When is the actual drop dead date of our budget?
It was supposed to be April.
We need to take a look at all of this and really. We need to try to retool this to move us forward. We can make a justification why we're doing it. I would like to stay within this ambition and not go up, because people go crazy when it goes up. I think it will work with all this, but I don't want to give away any more. Let's just leave, because as far as the people, there's $65,899 that we were approved last year. No one argued, it was adjusted. Let's see what we can do within that envelope, whether we can achieve these new numbers.
So we get an accurate budget and you can come back with a number.
I'll come back, I'll try to call several people.
And we'll put a band on the March.
Yes.
Okay. After our
very good.
Right.
Yes. So let's try to go over the data we need. Because I think we're at a watershed here. We need to sort of move forward.
Thank you for sharing.
It's very kind of you actually to let us know your plans. To just leave, and I've seen people do that. I've seen people do it, it's when they're right. So knowing that we can have an orderly transition is very, very much appreciated. It gives us plenty of time. So now we get to the zoning edit discussion. And I have not been as involved in that as I wanted to be, because I know that I apologize. But you seem to have been doing very well without me. Including finding things that in the table that should have been caught a long time ago. So, we're close. We're 95%. Then a little more to go and watch some really good regulations.
Well, just so you know, it goes up on the web tomorrow with the public hearing notice. So, it is what it is right now.
Well, maybe we should discuss that.
Well, you can't put it up with a public hearing notice if it's not finished.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but Okay, but the public hearing notice has to go up tomorrow.
Right.
If we go with that.
If you go with that.
If we go with that date.
Now, as I understand it, one of the things that, and Fred, came up was that on the table of uses, the main uses, a whole chunk of stuff was left off. So, and if you, I know Mike and I can go around the corner about whether or not, but if it's not available by special permit, and it's not a permitted use, it becomes a not a permitted use.
Correct.
Okay, now Mike has a different view on that, but the bottom line is, I don't want to see a bunch of things that are permitted now by a pocket, like being pigeonholed or a pocket veto being taken out. So we have a decision to make, which is very painful for me, because I've been wanting to move this along. Whether or not we want to rectify, there were two things that Fred found. One of them was this missing stuff in the table. The other one was less important, but still could be rectified. Do we want to take another month and delay the process yet again to get this stuff sorted out? And Fred, maybe you can explain in greater detail what you find, because I'm not doing a good job with it.
Oh, well, I found that there were several recreational and entertainment uses in the existing regulation table that did not make it into the draft. And let's see, I don't have that movement, but
it just oversight?
Was it exercise, it was theater?
Right, dance, studio, park and public parks, a couple of other ones.
And that has to go back, and that would have to then go to get back again to COG again.
However, yes, it would have to go to COG, but since we're discussing it, I will share with you my conversation with Dan McGinnis. Once he received the packet from this last time, he called me and he said, "What you sent are just the proposed changes from the original," and I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, since my thoughts didn't get," this is not exactly how he said it, "but since my thoughts didn't get into the document, I'm not wasting my time to review it. I have no comments."
Lovely public servant. Yeah, I love it.
And
What? Since my thoughts didn't get into...
He had things that he felt we should do, and we chose not to do it.
Oh,
because
so
we do the planning in Salisbury, not COG. We disagree.
Well, that's his comment, then.
And that's his comment. And some people can take that you give advice, thank you for your comment, we don't take it. Some people get a little bit more petulant about it. Case in point.
I'd like to the issue here that my understanding in working with the skedets and working with the workshops is that nobody has been through the existing regulations and made sure that everything made it over to the draft.
And that was something that was requested of Tom.
Tom. Yes.
And I don't feel that we can go any further until that has been done. And one of four sections that I edited for Garrett just recently, there was one parking table. So I sat down after Fred found that table was there and went through two pages of existing parking regulations. And those things that are highlighted on the second page didn't make it into the draft either. Now, I don't know whether these are significant issues.
Yes,
yes, they
because are. I wasn't at the meetings, and maybe the decision was made to drop these.
No, these are very significant issues, and I think point to the fact that somebody has got to do this. Tom clearly didn't do it, so someone has to do this, because we cannot, you know, the whole idea of these regulations was to finally remove the chaos, remove all the disconnects, and make it work. And we now have, you know, this has been, ever since I've been here, it's been like, well, this didn't move, this is like the whole, it didn't move from that table to that table. How many times have we heard this? And this is the one thing that we said we were not going to happen. So frankly, I feel that if we have to take a month and delay it and do this intense editing, and I think surely Tom is not going to do it. We could maybe ask Garrett if she wants to do it.
Well, how about if Garrett came into the office, she has the
means.
If she wishes to.
maybe if we pay her the rate that she's asked us to do.
And we sat side by side, and I went over, she has the new one, I have the old one.
This is what Frank, you and Tom were supposed to do. You and Tom were supposed to do that, and Tom never did it.
No, Tom never came in.
Motion to pay her the rate she wants.
Yes, please. And also, Nancy, individual input is really important, because for someone like me working with this, it's very hard. Because the sections don't follow, and I think there's been a terrific job done by Tom to reorganize, and that's great. And I think if the two of you went ahead and did that, I'd feel much more confident that we have everything the way we want, and 1 month doesn't matter the scheme of it.
Right. 1 month doesn't matter if we come to an end of it, we're not gonna get the, and we're gonna, I thought about this, we're gonna go forward with the LI 20 zone in at this point. We can't start pulling that out and doing that. It has to be stopped somewhere. If we take the LI 20 zone out, then we'll have to go back and search it all through. But we can't stop that anymore than we stop for the signs. But we have to stop for this, because this is an embarrassment. After all this money, and all this time, and all this effort, and we still have the same problems that plagued us, oh, that one piece didn't make it over.
We don't know what other problems there might be.
Well, we don't
have confidence.
Well, if you don't have confidence, so you really can't. Garrett, what do you feel about?
Well, what we need is a process that is going to catch whatever was behind and make sure that it has come forward. If we have that process, if the process is that Nancy and I sit down together, me with a printout of the new, you with a printout of the old, and we go through it regulation by regulation and make sure everything's transferred over, and then it gets copy edited again.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
It's a hell of a lot better than it was.
Oh, it's getting better over time, when something like this comes up, it just sends me into
It's upsetting to me as well, because the information wasn't there, and then the information that I did get, thinking that I was proofreading, it was massively...
There's two types of things. There's content review, and then there's format review, and then there's proofreading, and there are three distinct processes.
I did at least three different processes on this. I've been through this document four times now, doing this.
Inside out.
Well, I'm willing to do it. I can do it in March. I have some time to do it in March. But what I do need is the process for it. So if that's the process that's going to work.
Is that the process you think will work?
Yeah, if Nancy has the password, that is generally how you do this sort of thing.
Correct.
Two people, that is how you do
so
it.
So you could just say,
so that would be a heck of a lot easier than me trying to go back.
No, you can't. It's a problem. You need two people. You need two people to sit and make sure, but you want to make sure we have not lost things.
Yes, that's the first
thing. Because you can be sure it will come up with some citizen required. Then we'll look stupid again.
It's a lot.
Yes. Again.
The whole thing is a lot easier now.
Well, no, it's getting better.
Because it's also been like it's been formatted, so now everything looks the same. You know, the definitions are all the same.
It looks nice, but now we have to make sure that all the content is right.
Now we have to
that's
make sure
critical.
The content is
well,
critical.
We had a problem in our table from previously.
I remember all that. I think didn't get carried forward. I thought finally
we're working on.
Right. I thought finally here we were never going to have to say, oh, we forgot how long this isn't carried over. I remember this the first time I came to a meeting when I first started. Oh, we've done it so many times, it was always be done in patches. And I think there's a chance we're tearing the whole thing apart and building it up again, and it should be built right. Mm-hmm. You know, and if it takes another month, we'll do it.
Is a month going to be enough?
Yeah, it was. That's the other thing that's irritating. Is it doesn't take 3 years to do it. You just have to do it.
Okay. Well, just two people.
We're just
proofreading.
No, it's just two. You've got to have two people, one on each document, going through
it's
this.
Content proofing.
This is not it's content proofing, and then the whole thing will get reformatted and reline proofed again. That will go much quicker because it's now all lined up.
Right.
And then we'll have to have some check for the tables. If we lose a table in transition, because if it gets lost on the computer, then I get lost. We had one that was on a different page and we found it. You know, I mean,
Part of the problem.
Yes, I'm willing to do this, and I agree, it is embarrassing, and I sort of, I'm kind of stomping my feet, because this is the first time I've had a chance to take a crack at it. And I thought I was taking a crack at it at the end of the process, and it's really at the very beginning. So I just, wanted to say, wait a minute, I would be happy to do that.
Okay, part of the problem with the recreational and entertainment uses is that they were not in the text, but they have the existing regulation, but they were in the table. So that brings up the question, do we want them in the text?
Yes, yes.
As well as being in the.
That's another content proof feature. Content proofing, whether it's taken, and then you're finding content proofing, is it actually tied back to some verbiage? You can't have something sitting on a table.
Well, and it's not the design maps and all of that in a table, you know, is it?
Right.
Well, that's a lot of time.
It is.
It's a lot of time, but then also there has to be a process to.
There's a process, but you can't do it all. You have to, one, go through, and then you have to go through, you know this, and go through and see, okay, is everything in a table?
You have to go back to the beginning.
Is the thing in a table have a reference in the text? I mean, that's ridiculous. That's something in a table.
Right.
That's not in the text.
And there are probably definitions that need to go in.
So we define a process, and I think that it's.
You're happy with the process?
I'm happy with the process.
I'm happy paying Garrett $25 an hour for the process.
So good deal.
How many, when do we start? How many days a week? What's your schedule?
24 hours a day.
Never get in a crust of bread and water.
I can devote at least one day, if not one and a half.
That's why I'm concerned. Is a month, and I mean, I'm truly concerned, is a month enough to get it right?
I think it's.
Are you sure?
It's March.
That is more important to me is not trying, and it takes 3 more months to do.
I agree.
Well, I agree.
Are you really comfortable with a month? This is a lot of work.
Why don't we just come back in a month and see, report back to us?
There's no reason.
I mean, even if we delay the public hearing notice a month, well, no, it's finished. Let's not always be trying to get the public hearing in. Let's first get the product.
And I'm asking this not disrespectfully. This is a big product. And sometimes you have to stop on it and wipe your eyes clean and go away for a while and come back.
I think we need a motion to cancel the public hearing.
Absolutely.
Right? Cancel or postpone?
Cancel.
It's
going to publish tomorrow. No, Thursday. I'm sorry.
No.
Thursday.
You can't stop that? It's already gone to the paper, is that what you're saying?
What's today? Tuesday? I'm pretty sure it's already.
Oh, the journal?
The journal.
Oh, yeah. They go to bed. They go to bed tonight.
Their deadline was Friday.
Well, then we just have to publish the follow-up.
Publish another notice. Publish another notice that's been canceled.
And we'll be rescheduled on a future date.
Yeah, do. Due to technical difficulty beyond our control.
Would you put something on the front door, like a copy from the local journal with a stamp across that from the cancelled?
And I will put it on the table as well.
Okay, so the goal here, the goal here is that Garrett is going to work on this with Nancy. We're going to get a status update, and when we really feel that it is all okay, it'll go up on the web, and we'll set the public hearing. We're not going to try to second guess to push the public hearing. And we're not putting anything more in it. We're leaving what it is. No more new regs.
No, we're going to do a status update every 2 weeks.
Okay.
Well,
who's putting the motion? I'm not seated.
Well, the motion is, this was just, now we need a motion to cancel the hearing.
I'll make a motion to cancel the public hearing, which was scheduled for March 5th.
Second.
Okay.
And to publish legal notice of such.
Yes.
Okay. Cancel public hearings and public notices.
I will call the paper, but I'm sure. And they might have a little blurb, a space where they can put something.
I think because they start blurring by noon, I think she's in print already.
Yeah.
I think you're right.
There. There's a vote. Is a motion on the table to cancel, is there a second? Thank you.
What's the second?
Second?
Yes, second.
It was.
Second?
Second. I second. Mm-hmm. We all second.
We all second. Well, second from
I second.
Second from Flynn.
I got it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Public hearing is canceled.
Okay, can I bring up the other problem, which was
Impervosities?
Yeah, section 210.5, major home occupancies.
Section?
Section 210.5, I'm sorry, 210.5.
Yes.
0.7. Goes over onto page 2-11, Roman numeral 2-11. Refers to parking areas paved and unpaved and other impervious surfaces. And we have established here that unpaved parking areas are not considered impervious.
Impervious.
Elsewhere in the regulations. So,
maybe for home office they're impervious because of all the heavy traffic from all the commercial.
So unpaved should come out of that?
Well, could we just simply, as a matter of putting in
paved, so we just call it paved parking areas?
Well, I'm just calling it parking areas. Isn't that what's really what they care about?
Well, it's...
Is it about water quality or is it about parking?
The maximum ratio of the total footprint area of all impervious surfaces on the lot, including buildings, parking areas, paved and unpaved, and other impervious surfaces, to the total lot area shall be 20%. So it's about impervious surfaces.
Yeah,
so unpaved should be taken out of that.
Right.
Well, we still haven't made a designation yet. I mean, we've discussed it.
We have not made a designation.
But that would make it
unpaved are pervious, according
that's
to
right.
regulations right now.
Right.
Unpaved are pervious. So that's not correct.
Right.
Correct.
So it should say,
get rid of unpaved.
It should say paved parking areas.
Paved parking areas, okay. So paved parking areas.
It doesn't say driveways. I wonder if it should say paved parking areas and driveways.
And maybe that's in the driveway. Now you have to look at the driveway rings and make sure that it's kind of the same.
You know what?
This is a good thing.
The maximum ratio of total warm impervious surfaces of the lot. Why don't we just be simple? Shall be 20%. We don't even need the whole line. Why do we have
some? Oh, that's right.
That's it. The maximum ratio of total warm impervious surface of the lot shall be 20%.
Much better. Yeah.
There we go. Out it goes.
See, the job's getting short again.
No.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Okay, but now where does that piece of paper go?
Where does that paper go?
Yeah, because now if we're going into the rewrite process, that edit has to get over to me to get it.
Hey, that's my piece of paper.
Make sure he gets his little piece of paper back.
For the, it's 2-11, right?
Yes.
Make it over there, Fred, you got a paper.
That's what I think. That's right.
I'll make a
photocopy. Make a photocopy for Fred. I don't want to hear him whining.
I can see it.
It's all right, you're going to get one now.
I'll do it.
Yeah, press the holes too, please.
You just need a copy of
it. I'll punch
the holes. She knows that.
Okay. Let's. Okay. Now that we've sort of found a role for Garrett, she's going to be the grand involvement poobah of the United. We have a bill for Garrett for 31 hours. Garrett has requested that she be paid at the rate that we paid her for POCD work, not at a secretarial rate because of the complexity and scope of the work. I think this is very reasonable. We certainly have the funds. Is that agreeable to everybody?
Money well spent.
Would you like a motion to
that? Oh, I don't know.
Yeah. The only thing I will say to Garrett is it would be next time, try to work this out ahead of time. It's always easier to agree this ahead of time rather than after the fact. I have no problem.
I didn't know what I was going to get.
Well, you know what you're getting.
That's why I called you, remember?
Oh, that's right.
After 1 hour, I called you and said.
It's ready to vote. I'm ready, I've already signed it, so can we approve the expenditure to Garrett of $775?
So moved.
By Mike, seconded by
Alan.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
And I've signed it, aye, so you can go do battle with Joe, if you need to.
You want a formal motion to authorize her to continue?
Yeah, probably would be at $25 an hour, yes.
Yeah, so moved. So we're finished with the rewrite.
Okay, thank you.
And all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And the emphasis really on this is to get it right, not necessarily at least the speed, because we've got to give it one chance.
Okay, thank you. So Nancy, do you want to start Friday?
You give it to Fred, you can, oh, give it back to him. Here it is. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I'm like, I'll let you get your paper back.
All those numbers are in before we can make our.
Okay, I think we had a.